The Lord tonight, the Lord is good. Amen. As we open in prayer tonight, we have a special prayer request that we need to remember in prayer. Sister Debbie wants us to remember her brother that's having surgery tomorrow. We need just to remember him in prayer. So as we open in prayer tonight, can we take this need to, his name was Freddie, right? 3 o'clock. Let's stand and take these knees to the Lord in prayer and invite the Lord's presence into the service tonight. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity you have to come before your presence tonight, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord, in your presence there is fullness of joy. And at your right hand there is pleasures forevermore. We come before your presence to worship you. We come before your presence to praise you. We come before your presence to magnify you and to glorify you, Lord. Father, Lord, we pray for this special need tonight. Lord, Sister Summerall's brother Freddie that's having this surgery tomorrow. You're able to lead and guide the doctor's hands, Lord. Let there be no problems. Let there be no victory, no difficulties, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Just let your complete healing virtue to flow. We pray tonight that you'd have your way tonight in this service. Touch Sister Rebecca as she ministers to us tonight. Father, Lord, give her a mighty touch of the Holy Ghost, Lord. Bless the praise team as they sing tonight, Lord. Just lift us up into the heavenlies tonight, Lord. We pray, Lord, that thy perfect will would be done and your Holy Ghost would move among our hearts and our lives and would stir us and mold us and make us and form us and shape us into your image and that you'd have us to do tonight, Lord. Father God, we give you the thanks and the praise and the glory, Lord. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. Let's remain standing and worship the Lord tonight.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. Well, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day. Yes, this is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that
Hallelujah. We have a river of life, and it can flow out of us.
I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Open prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Open prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up a well within my soul. Spring up a well and make me whole. Spring up a well and give to me the life abundantly. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. It makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up a well within my soul. Spring up a well and make me whole. Spring up a well and give to me the life abundantly. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Yes, I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up a well within my soul. Spring up a well and make me whole. Spring up a well and give to me the life abundantly. Spring up a well within my soul. Spring up a well.
Hallelujah. We thirst for that water from that everlasting well.
We thirst for you. We search for you. In a dry and barren land, we're longing for your hand to guide us to a place where you can cleanse us with your rain, baptize us once again. We thirst for you. Where you can cleanse Jesus, once again we thirst for you.
Oh, Lord, Lord, we are waiting.
Lord, we are waiting. Let your river flow. Come, flood our hearts again. Quench our thirsty souls. We thirst for you. We search for you. In a dry and barren land, we're longing for your hand to guide us to a place where you can cleanse us with your rain. Baptize us once again. We thirst for you.
Have a desire, amen, a thirst of the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you for that tonight, team. Choir, come on up at this time. Let's continue to worship the Lord in song tonight, singing out of that red bank book. Hallelujah. I'm thankful for the heritage I have in the Church of God. Thankful for Pentecost tonight. Thankful, Lord, for those red back songs, those red back hymnals. It might have been green in the church you grew up. Might have been blue in some, but that church hymnal, let's sing out of it tonight. Ask the Lord just to help us. In that red back book, 393 simply says, when we all get to heaven, let's sing it together tonight.
We are the
Sweeter and sweeter every day. Amen. Going to heaven. to be with my Lord and my Savior. Welcome to our Sunday night service. Trust that you have already felt the presence of the Lord tonight. I'm ready to see what He has in store for us. Amen. Don't forget about all the announcements of this week. Monday night. Nothing tomorrow night for church. And Tuesday night's praise and prayer. Wednesday night's church. Thursday night's church over at Spirit Life. Friday night's our fall festival. Thank you for those that brought in candy today, and some come by and today and said, I'll bring you some this week in the office. So we'll be here. Drop that by. Going to have a grand old time. Be here at 6 o'clock Friday night, 6 o'clock until 8 o'clock. All of the events, the bounce houses, dunk tanks, all those things that I mentioned this morning, food and some giveaways, some door prizes, some games for the little guys, and candy upon candy upon candy. So be with us this coming Friday night from 6 o'clock until 8 o'clock. And then the weekend is time change, and then next Sunday we'll do it all over again. That's if Jesus doesn't come. If He raptures the church out of here, I'm ready to go. Amen. And looking forward to spending eternity with Him. So glad to have Pastor Sister Renfro back tonight. Did you miss them this morning? Amen. Miss them when they're not here. They helped us out over at our daughter campus over at Spirit Life. Said they had a good crowd, a good service there. So thankful for their commitment to the kingdom of the Lord. All right, ushers, get ready to wait upon us tonight. Give us an opportunity to worship with our tithes and our offerings. Now, if you'll come tonight and get ready to serve while they're coming, I will remind you that after service tonight, the ladies' department, the women's discipleship, I think is the correct name, has prepared chili and all the fixings back there. And for a small donation, you can come back and enjoy with us, and a little bit of a fundraiser for them and a time around the table. And they're having chili and chili and chili and more chili. Now, there's words before all those chilies. I just don't remember what they are. Green chili and purple chili and yellow chili. No, I don't know what it is. I heard white something another. Just go back there and eat. Amen. If you don't eat it, I'm going to have to all week long. And I know you would not want me to do that. I got home from the office last night rather early, about 8 o'clock, 8:15 or so, and Wendy had stuff everywhere. I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm cooking for tomorrow night. So one of the kids asked her, well, what's for lunch tomorrow? She says, I don't know. I haven't gotten that far yet. I said, what do you do? Skip right over lunch and go straight to dinner tomorrow night? She says, yes, this has to be done. And I guess it kind of cooked all night around the house, and we woke up smelling it this morning and things of that nature. So hopefully some of it will be worth eating tonight. Amen. She wasn't the only one. Other ladies helped out as well. We're thankful for that. But stay around the table tonight. Fellowship with us. The preacher don't preach real long tonight. You can get a bowl of chili and still be home in a decent hour. If she preaches long tonight, it's not my fault. I told her she preached too long, I was getting up and leaving. Amen. I would not do that, but I asked her that, and she says, I don't know. Well, that kind of helps me, because if she's preaching a long time, I'm going to sit on that pew. It's a lot more padded than that chair is. I'll stay up here tonight and amen her from the platform. Let's give tonight as giving to the Lord. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you for the word of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the blessed hope that we have in Jesus as our soon returning Savior. I pray that you'll bless this offering tonight. Take it for its intended use. Multiply it tonight, and we'll forever be grateful. In the name of Jesus, we ask. And everybody said amen. Hold on just a minute. I forgot to mention something. I need you to help me. I haven't asked the finance director. I haven't talked to anybody. But I'll ask for forgiveness later. Amen. I got a letter in the mail a few days ago. How many of you know where Crescent City, Florida is? Anybody know where that's at? Up near Palatka, just south of Palatka. I got it probably a week and a half ago, and I've just put it on my desk, and I can't get rid of it. And I've just had that. But I worked in that area. I know what they're facing there. The pastor there was in a wreck several months ago, a wreck so bad that it's taken him out of the ministry, and they went several months with no pastor. They now have a pastor, and now that new pastor is trying to pick up the pieces and continue on. During the time of no pastorate, there was nobody living in the parsonage, and the parsonage sprung a leak, and it's almost ruined the parsonage. I mean, they're having to do lots of work, and so they have simply just sent me a letter sharing with me their need, and like I said, we don't have a lot of money to give away, but I still believe it's more blessed to give than to receive. Amen. And so tonight, I'm going to take a portion of this general offering, not our tithes and not our designated funds, but a portion of the general offering. And I'm going to send that. I would love to send them $100 or $2 tonight. And I don't know that we have that on the floor, but all I want to do is present the need to you. And if you can't give it tonight, you can give it Wednesday night. You just mark it church or roof or Crescent City, and we'll know what to do with it. But I just have been burdened for them. And you say, Pastor, we have our own responsibility. We do. We do. But that community needs a church as well. And if I can help them along the way a little bit, I believe God would be pleased with that. So if you can dig a little deep tonight, give an extra 5 or 10 or 20, and we'll take it and we'll put it toward that project and send them a little love offering to help them along the way. God bless you as you give tonight. If you're giving to the Lord tonight, Sister Tegan's coming to minister to you in song. While she's coming, I do want to remind you, going into the month of November, 2 weeks from this weekend, we'll begin revival for the Lamar Chapman. And as I announced to, I think, the crowd Wednesday night, he's bringing a young guy with him, Justin Overstreet, a 25-year-old guy, individual, married, been called into ministry. He'll be spending the week with us here that week. He'll be doing 2 of our day services for chapel. And we're going to have a little spiritual mini renewal revival service that week with school, middle school and high school students. And so set that date aside. It's been in the back of your bulletin at Events at a Glance. And it's going to be a great week in the Lord. And then later on in the month of November, we're going to have our Thanksgiving dinners, the David Holly Memorial Fund Thanksgiving dinners. And Pastor Renfro's mentioned that. So don't forget about all of that. It's a way to get involved. We have plenty for us to do for the kingdom of the Lord. So let's do what we can to help others find the Lord. Worship with Sister Tegan as she ministers to you in song tonight.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul, and I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is no more sorrow.
branding. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise beneath these wings before my God.
And ask our youth choir to come on up at this time and get ready to sing for you again tonight. Didn't they do a wonderful job this morning? Amen. Looking forward to hearing them again tonight. Amen. While they are coming, let me ask you to remember Pastor Ricky and Sister Christy in prayer. They have a big day on Tuesday, and I know that God's able to be with them, bring back to their memory all the things they have prepared and studied for, and we're just believing for a good report on Tuesday, and I'm so proud of them, proud of Brendan and Tegan are going through CAMS, and that's been a process for them, just a lot of ministry happening, not only every weekend here, but also throughout the week and in the hearts and lives of others, and this group of kids behind you is a product of that, and I'm thankful for that, thankful for what God is doing in their life, and thankful that we get to be a part of it, amen, to see them grow and to use their talents for the Lord. Let's worship with them tonight as they minister to us in song.
I'm thankful for God, for my school, and for my family, and for my parents.
Eyes of man, seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. Yeah. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we'll step into the valley unafraid. We call out to the ashes.
Hallelujah. That's our prayer tonight. Breathe on us, O Spirit of the Lord. Amen. Great job again, youth choir and team members there. Miss Rebecca, Pastor Rebecca's coming to minister to us the word of the Lord tonight. So thankful for what God's doing in her life and the many wonderful things that God has afforded to her for ministry. Would you welcome her to this platform as she comes tonight to bring the word of the Lord?
I'm not sure how I feel about Pastor sitting up there. Maybe I should tell you I'm going to preach a long time and you'll go down there. I don't know which one's worse. Being that I am the youth pastor, we have an illustration a little bit tonight, so that's what the box will be for. So just don't get them yet. Just, it's okay. The guys in the back are ready to go. But tonight we're going to talk about the love of God. Good thing to talk about. But as I was preparing for this, A.W. Tozer wrote a book called The Knowledge of the Holy, and in his chapter on God being love, he said that a person trying to describe the love of God is like a child reaching up to grasp a star. It's impossible to do, but in the reaching for it, other people will see the direction they're reaching and will look up and notice the star. So it's not possible in one short sermon to obviously capture the fact that God is love, but I hope that you get out of it what God has given me out of it, because he's challenged me as I've read and as I've studied for tonight's message. If you'll turn your Bibles to Revelation chapter 2, when you start to think about God as love, this is probably not where you're going to go normally, but this is where I felt led to start. So Revelation chapter 2, I'm going to read verses 1 through 7, and then we're going to go from there to 1 John chapter 4. So if you want to go ahead and find 1 John chapter 4 in your Bibles, or those of you, that's one of the drawbacks of phones. You can't go to two places. Let's stand for the reading of God's Word. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience for my name's sake, hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come to thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And if you'll turn to 1 John chapter 4, I'm going to go to verses 16 through 19. Just a moment. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin service tonight. Father, I come before you humbly as I know how, Lord, asking right now that you'll anoint me. God, that you'll put your words in my mouth. God, don't let me say anything that is not pleasing to you. But God, I pray that your Spirit will anoint me now. Lord, hide me behind your cross. God, I pray right now that you'll anoint the ears of the hearers. Lord, help our hearts to receive what you have for us in your word, knowing that your word will never return void. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. With the exception to the letter to the church at Laodicea, this is probably the best known of the letters to the church. You got off the platform. Does that mean my time is up? Okay, just wanted to check. That's what you said. With the exception of the letter to the church of Laodicea, this is probably the best known of the letters to the seven churches. But it's one of those passages that if you think about it, it kind of makes you squirm a little if you read a little too closely, because to talk about losing their first love, when you look at the Ephesian church, you can see the birth of that church in Acts. I think it's chapter 19. Paul goes to the town of Ephesus and finds some people there that believed in John's baptism but hadn't yet been filled with the Holy Ghost. He prays for them. The Holy Ghost falls with the evidence of speaking in tongues, and a church is planted. Paul stays there. Some people say he stayed there as long as maybe 2 years, that the Apostle Paul poured into them. So this was a church that had seen a mighty outpouring of God's power. It had been founded on sound doctrine. It had withstood persecution. This is the place that Paul, his preaching was so effective that the people who sold the idols to the false god thought they were going to lose so much money that they rioted and they yelled, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." And they were afraid that the Roman guards were going to come and take over the city because it was such persecution. They actually took one of the members of the Christian church there and beat him because of his faith. So there was persecution, but there was also from that a huge revival to the point that people who practiced witchcraft were bringing their books and their spells and they were putting them in a giant fire. They didn't sell them. They didn't do anything with them. They burned them. So this huge experience of the power of God there. Then, of course, when Paul is on his way back to Jerusalem at the end of his missionary journeys, before he goes to prison and eventually is killed, he stops near Ephesus, calls for the elders of the church to meet his ship at one of the ports, and says, "When I leave you, false doctrine is going to come in." So he warned them, took the time. He wrote them the letter that we know as Ephesians, and he prayed for them. This is the prayer, and he prayed in Ephesians 3:14 through 19. "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God." If there was ever a church in the New Testament that should know what it meant to love God with all their heart, it would have been the Ephesian church, with all the teaching and all the prayers that have been prayed there. What happened to them, though? If you look at them on the outside from our text in Revelation 2, it looked like everything was going well. They were doing good works. In fact, they were doing good works to the point that they were laboring. They were reaching the point of even physical exhaustion. They were spending all their strength doing everything that they could to do these good works. But they weren't actually getting tired of the works they were doing. They were not weary in well-doing. They were laboring for God. And they were patient. God commended them. Christ commended them for their patience. They resisted false doctrines, and they stood up against evil leaders that had come in that were going to lead them astray. But Jesus still found something to rebuke them. Not that he was standing there nitpicking, but this was very important. He found that they had left their first love. Not that they had lost it. Sometimes I misquote that and I say they lost it. They didn't lose it. They left it. The love that they had left was that first love, that first passion that they have for God. How can a church that got so much right have missed the importance of loving God? The word that they use, that the writer uses here for left, gives us a clue about what happened. Left, in other translations, is sometimes put as the word abandoned. They walked away from their first love. The word, the Greek word there, can mean to forsake, to lay aside, to leave it, to let it be or let it go, to put it away or to yield it. It actually is the same word that is even used of a husband divorcing his wife, to put it away. And it can mean to go away and leave something behind. I'm going to do my little illustration here. Hannah volunteered earlier. So she's going to come up here, and while she's coming, the guys are going to go get my other boxes out of the back. Hannah, I'm going to give you a box. It's a pretty box. Just hold on to that box, okay? Because the guys are going to bring you something else that you got to hold to. It's going to take them a moment because there's a lot you're going to have to hang on to. If y'all just line those boxes up on the altar here. Like I said, I do youth. I have to do an illustration of some kind, or I get bored. Some of y'all missed that. Y'all weren't listening. You were bored. Hannah, only one of these is heavy. All right, the rules are simple. You have to pick up all the boxes and hold them, but you can't put boxes inside of other boxes. Okay? Let's see if you can do this for me. Oh, what did you walk away from? Did you just set your first box down? Why'd you set it down? I told you to hold that. You gotta pick that one up. You can't set it down. Okay, now you can keep going. That's pretty impressive. You set it down again. Now that's impressive. We should give her a hand. Good job. All right, you can have a seat. How hard was it to do that without setting that box down? Would it have been easier if I, or seemed easier if I let you set it down? Probably. The Ephesian church was given God's love, their first love, but they got so busy doing stuff. First thing they did, you know, they had works they did for God. So they, you know, pick up the works. They had the labors. They had the tribulation they faced. They had the false doctrine. But somewhere along the way, as they picked all that up, they set their first love down. And at first, it's an idea of just set it down temporarily and walked away while they were doing something else. Well, then they realized they didn't really miss that extra box. They were able to do things just fine without it. And then they intentionally were at the point of walking away from that love. See, they'd reached a place, they were in the danger, I'll say, of reaching a place of pride. I can do it myself without God. They left behind that relationship with God. What they had ended up doing was just completely losing focus on what was the most important thing, that relationship. We read in 1 John 4:16 that God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Love is one of the attributes of our God. Just as he's holy and he's faithful and he's just and true, he is love. And the way he loves us is wonderful. The cure, well, I won't jump ahead there. Okay. An everlasting love is one of the kinds of love that God has for us. Jeremiah 31:3, the Lord hath appeared unto me of old, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. I have a tendency sometimes to think that because I mess up, God doesn't love me like he used to. And I cover that messing up by trying to do more. More work, more labor, more patience, more endurance, more resisting temptation, more whatever. But what I'm really covering up is that I don't feel as close to God as I once did. I've walked away maybe from that love. I've forgotten that it's everlasting, that he truly loves me. Another thing is that it's a safe love. Romans 8:15 doesn't even mention love. Neither does Deuteronomy 33:27, but both of them apply here. Romans 8:15 says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Deuteronomy 33:27 says, the eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. It's the picture of a child and their father, and the child on the edge of a step jumping into the father's arms. We've seen that illustration before. We've heard it before. But it's this idea that I can jump and trust that my daddy will catch me. It's that kind of safe love that's holding us up. When I'm afraid that I've failed God so much that he'll never forgive me, his love is there catching me, keeping me when I fall, because he doesn't want to destroy me. He wants a relationship with me. Love doesn't work if the other party doesn't love you back. You know, I mean, I won't pull two teenagers up here, but I could pull two teenagers up here and have them pretend to be boyfriend, girlfriend. They switch so often. It's like your head spins. You can't keep up with it. It's worse than a comic serial book, whatever. It's just crazy. One minute they'll be, oh, I love you. And then over here, oh, I love you too. And then this one will be like, ooh, she's pretty. And they forgot the other one. Because they got distracted, they looked somewhere else, so their love wasn't constant. It doesn't work. This one may still be desperately in love with that boy, but that boy doesn't love her back. Love doesn't work that way. That's not what God is like. He doesn't get distracted and go, oh, this is my new favorite child. I'm sorry, you messed up. Goodbye. You are the weakest link. Goodbye. For those of you who remember that. But he doesn't do that. His love is enough that it's there for all of his children. He loves Hannah, and he loves Natasha. He loves Nicholas. Sometimes, I don't know about Nicholas. No, I'm kidding. I love my youth students. Another thing, though, is that a father's love would not truly be the right kind of father's love if there wasn't a disciplining love in it. If you let your kids get away with everything, you don't really love them. Because a parent's love desires the best for their child. And they know that the only way that their child can become the best that they are supposed to be is if sometimes they're corrected. The Father's love for us, Hebrews 12, 5 and 6 says, "And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth," or disciplines, "and he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." Our Father's love for us is everlasting, and it is safe. But it sometimes is going to correct us. God's going to pull us up short and say, you're going the wrong way. It doesn't mean he loves us any less. In fact, if God corrects something in your life, it is proof of his love for you. If you feel that God has challenged you to give something up because it takes you away from him, it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. He loves you so much, he's jealous for your affection. He loves you so much, he wants you to be the best person, the person he's called you to be. I'm not into Joel Osteen's Your Best Life Now by any means, but God does have a plan for your life, and to bring you into the ministry and into the calling that he has on your life, sometimes he's got to correct you, or all you'll ever be is a spoiled brat. It's not loving to your child to let them become a spoiled brat. I'm going to go back to my notes. I'm actually walking tonight. That's different. Probably the most dramatic demonstration of love, of course, is that God's love is a sacrificing love. And we're so quick to say to people, Jesus loves you. And they're like, oh, that's nice, warm, fuzzy feelings. But God's love is not a light thing when you think about what Jesus did on the cross for us. Romans 5:9, I believe it is, God commendeth or shows his love to us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Now, with all the love that God has for us, Jesus is different. He is the only begotten, the beloved Son of God. God gave the thing that he loved the most for you. Can you imagine that? I mean, How often have you thought, oh, that person, just use illustration, that person needs a new jacket. I think I have an old kind of beat up one in my closet I'm going to give them. You ever done that? You're quick to give away things you don't use anymore, things you don't need, and that's normal. But God didn't give us a cast off. He gave his best. His love for you is so rich that he was willing to give up his best to save you. All out of love. And as I read this today, it truly convicted me, because how often have I been so, like the Ephesian church, so focused on the ministry that we do. And ministry that we do here is great. Pastor and I have talked, Sister Wendy in the office, about all the stuff that happens here during the week. I mean, you just don't realize how many people there are when there are 75 or so kids and all the staff members on campus. There are a lot of people here. We see a lot of folks during the week. People that come to church, people that stop by. We have boys club and girls club and kids church and helping people in the community sometimes. So much happens. But sometimes I think that as long as I pour into that, it's okay. And I forget that my greatest treasure is my relationship with God. There's a verse, I believe, in Song of Solomon that says, my beloved is mine, and I am his. To be able to say with boldness, I love God, and God loves me. He is mine, and I am his. There's nothing else from any other religion in this world that can compare. You could work to become the best Muslim ever. You could do all the five pillars of Islam, but they don't teach that Allah loves you like Jesus loved us. He didn't die for you. Our God died for us. That's amazing to me. And then you have this church that has forgotten that. And it seems sort of off topic, but one thing that I thought of as I studied, the first sin that ever happened, Adam and Eve, the result of that, they went and they hid in the trees of the garden. Out of shame, they hid from God. And you wonder, of course it was natural for them to hide because they had messed up. I would have hidden. They were ashamed. But I wonder, they didn't really comprehend the depth of God's love for him. Because look what God did. He found them. His everlasting love compelled him to seek out these two that had sinned against him. He went searching. Adam, where are you? He went looking for them. He disciplined them. He said, there's some consequences to your actions. But even in his discipline, there was love. Even in sending them away from the garden, there was love, because he was afraid that while they were in the garden, they would, in that fallen state, eat the tree of life and live forever in a world where they were separated from God. So in his discipline, there was mercy. He sent them away so that there would be hope that one day they could have a relationship with him again where they had been forgiven. And he clothed them. He protected them from the elements. He loved them as a father. But it wasn't until Christ came that the length and breadth and depth and height of God's love would be truly understood, until he sacrificed his own son. God wants to do good toward us. He loves us. He rejoices in us. He doesn't need our love, but he wants it. In every element of human relationship, to some extent, it becomes a need. You get so attached to the other person, you need them. God's love does not need us. It is pure in that he simply wants your love. He deserves your love. He desires that. The verse at the end of 1 John 4:19 says that we love him because he first loved us. So what was Jesus' message to the church at Ephesus? What did he say they should do to fix this problem of leaving their first love? He says, remember from where you've fallen. Remember I said that what they might have could have done is they left their box. They left their first love. They went over there. Have you ever lost something in your house? Where did I put that? Where are my keys? Where's my phone? Where's my pencil? Whatever. You lose it. So you have to stop and think, where did I put that? And when you remember, if you need that item, what do? You turn around and you pick it up. Do you know what the word repent means? To turn around. He told him, remember from whence you have fallen. Remember what you set down. Remember the love that God has for you. Repent. Turn around and go back and pick it up. He says, do the first works again. Remember the love that you had for God when you first understood how much he loved you. For me, when I think about when I got saved as a child, I was really short even then. I was 6 or 7, and we had a little craft in kids' church, and we made the cross and took it home. And I remember we had a little cutout of Jesus on this green styrofoam, floral styrofoam stuff cross. sitting in the car, dropped off either Granny or Grandpa Johnson. I'm just sitting there. It's like, light bulb. Oh my goodness. Jesus died for me. He did that for me. And I loved him in that moment. But it's easy to let your love get buried under all the other stuff, to think it's just a little box. I'll sit it down for a while and I'll pick up all the big boxes first, and then I'll put the little box back on top of it and I have everything. But that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to treasure him. And of all the things that we do at our church, of all the things that I do and have the privilege of doing for God, we had a guy that stopped the other day, Scott Anderson. He was doing some classes at Southeastern University, and he had to interview someone in ministry. So he's like, calls me or Facebooks me and says, can I interview you? One of the questions he asked was, you know, why do you do what you do? And we heard this when we were at CJAC's. Why, asking educators, why do you do what you do? If you think about your life right now, why are you doing what you're doing? The why is the most important thing. I can do all of the stuff for God, but why I do it is because I love him and I have a relationship with him, and all ministry should flow out of that relationship. And this has convicted me, because even this afternoon studying for it, I want to go back and do my first works again, and I found myself in prayer saying, God, let me love you like I did the day you saved me. Let me be as captivated with your love. These kids, when they do, you know, find a new boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever that they have going on there, I mean, it's funny. They're just like, oh, he's so cute. Oh, I'm going to go sit next to him. Uh-huh. Or, oh, I got a text. Or worse, I don't have a text. I mean, they live or die by, emotionally, they live or die by communication with that person that they like. When was the last time I felt like that about Jesus? And I'm convicting myself here. When was the last time that it was, I have to know what he says about the situation. I can't move forward until I talk to him. I can't do ministry until I talk to him and know that this is where he wants me to go. And the end of what Christ said to the church at Ephesus was, he said that to him that overcometh, he didn't say to the whole church when it finally overcomes, but he said to him that overcometh, and he said, he that hath an ear, let him hear. So this is a call in Revelation to an entire church. It was a call to the church because they lost their love for God. But it was also a call to individuals to listen. And to the individuals that overcame, look what he promised. He promised that they could eat the tree of life. That way back in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve lost because of their sin. The love for God would restore that relationship and would one day allow us to live forever with him. When we sang, when we all get to heaven, it says, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. And those that song and Oh I Want to See Him are two of my favorite, because it puts heaven in a different perspective. It's not just about streets of gold anymore, but it's about seeing the one we love. It's about that long wait to finally see the face of the beloved. And I don't even really know how to close tonight, although whoever's doing altar, if you want to come on. But to say this, God has things for Oakway Church of God to do, and he has ministries for everyone here from the youngest to the oldest. But in all that he has for us to do, the most important thing is your relationship with him. If you're like me, there have been days where you've doubted your salvation, where you've said, am I good enough? Do I have everything right? I'm afraid that I don't. But the verses that we read says there's no fear in love. To know that God loves you and sent his son for you, he will keep you and he will help you if you are striving to serve him. If you're doing what you know he's called you to do, his love is going to keep you. it's going to protect you. He's going to discipline you and correct you as you go. But tonight, if you feel that there may be some place in your life where you need to be closer to Him, maybe you don't love Him like you once did. No matter who you are, whether you've been a pastor or a teacher or a leader, or whether you've sat on the pew for most of your, you know, and prayed for people, that's the calling God's given you, or whether you're a child still trying to figure out what ministry God's called you into. If you don't love Him like you did the day you got saved, you need to find an altar tonight. If you're afraid of tomorrow, of the future, you need to remind yourself of the love of God and what He's done for you. Let's go ahead and stand. I'll go back up here behind the pulpit. What God gave them to do was simple. Remember from whence you're fallen. Remember that love. Repent. Turn around and go back to it and do the first works again. The other person that may be here tonight is someone who has never known what it's like to have a relationship with God. If you've never found yourself in love with Jesus, I hope that you'll see Him as the Savior, as the God who loved you so much to give His life for you. I'm going to open these altars tonight. If you feel the need to pray, to talk to God, to draw closer to Him, I invite you to come forward.
In you, for this I was created, for this I was born, to fall in love with Jesus, body, soul, and mind. And now that you found me, I just can't get enough. I'm gonna worship morning, noon, and night. Live in your presence every day of my life. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. Adam, where art thou? Was the cry God called as He walked alone in the garden in the cool of the day. You don't have to come looking for me, Lord, here am I. I love being in your presence. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love basking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love basking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. Adam, where art thou? Was the cry our God called as he walked alone in the garden in the cool of the day. But you don't have to come looking for me. Oh, here am I. I love being in your presence. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. Adam, where art thou? Was the cry God called as he walked alone in the garden in the cool of the day. But you don't have to come looking for me. Lord, here am I. I love being in your presence. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace.
I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love asking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love basking in your grace. I love worshiping you. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love basking in your grace. I love, oh, let's sing it one more time tonight. I love being in your presence. I love living in your mercy. I love basking in your grace. I love worshiping you. Hallelujah for that design, God.
I love living in your mercy.
I love
basking in your grace.
I love worshiping
you.
Father, we thank you for the privilege tonight to be back in the house of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your servant, God, that reminded us that we need to return to that first love, God. Lord, works and ministry, God, have their place, but let us not replace that love that you've required of us, God, with things, Lord, that we do. Let us not abandon it, Lord. Let us not divorce that love, but, Lord, let us hold it near and dear to our hearts. Let us fall in love with you over and over and over again. Lord, let us remind ourselves, God, of the love that you had for each and every one of us, Lord, when you sent your Son, and he willingly came to die on a cross, Lord, and to shed his life that we might have life. Lord, be with us tonight, I pray, as we leave from this place. Lord, give us traveling mercy. Lord, give us an opportunity this week to display the love of Jesus to those that we come in contact with. Lord, bless the food that's been received. Be prepared to our body, Lord, that we're about to receive, and we'll forever give you praise, honor, and glory for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray tonight. Everybody said amen.